SpaceX is getting ready to test Starship S-37 in an exciting new way. Instead of waiting for repairs at their usual location, they plan to conduct static fire tests on Launch Pad A for Ship 37 and Ship 38. This is new for them because Pad A is meant to house super heavy boosters, not just Starship. So how are they going to do it? After some damage to their facility, SpaceX has two options: repair the location and it will take several months, or test directly on Pad A, which will speed up the process but also come with challenges. Elon Musk has decided to go with the latter option. SpaceX even posted a notice about a two-hour road closure starting at midnight on June 27th, but didn't say where. It turns out they were moving equipment for the Starship transport bay to the launch site. Fans are excited because it looks like they plan to set up this temporary space for testing. On June 28th, while most people were sleeping, activity was bustling on Pad A. They began building a special support structure on top of the launch pad to hold Starship during the test. The plan involves welding the transport cradle to the existing launch cradle, but they'll have to make some changes to make sure everything fits. This setup is temporary and will help them test Ship 37 and Ship 38 before they are deployed. The design is safe because the launch cradle is built to withstand a lot of weight and force from all the engines firing. Since they're only testing one stage of Starship, they're confident it can handle it. What do you think of SpaceX's plan? Considering running a test for Ship 37 on Pad A. If you support this, please say, "Let's do it," in the comments. I'd love to hear from you. Right now, it looks like setting up a test site on Pad A is a matter of a few days to a week. However, there are a few key changes that we still need to make before we can do a static fire test. For example, the standard quick disconnect is only mounted like a robotic arm on the launch tower, and the BQD is not aligned with the Starship fuel and data ports. This likely means SpaceX will have to set up a temporary SQD to make this test work. Other than that, the setup looks solid. Pad A has a water drainage system for water flow in the heat sinks, which will help control any issues that may arise. It already has full storage tanks, safety systems, remote control features, and all the infrastructure needed to monitor and collect test data. Some might say it's even better than the one at Massey. Musk's decision is not only bold, it's smart, and could move the Starship Flight 10 launch schedule forward by about a month. So when do we think Flight 10 will launch? If all goes according to plan, the launch could happen as early as August instead of October, especially if they don't wait for the Massey site to be fully repaired. Now let's talk about Pad B. Is it ready for a new Starship flight? Many have been watching Pad B, especially after the Massey incident. Pad B has quickly become a prime candidate for a Starship launch, while Pad A has been more focused on testing. Last week, we saw some good progress on the launch site with the installation of manifold pipes, which will connect to the water sinking system and fire trench. Additionally, new propellant farm tanks were brought in, along with 8 clamps for attachment. There will be 20 clamps on Pad B, one for each outer ring engine on the Super Heavy booster. These clamps are strong enough to keep everything upright in high winds and static fires, and will release just before liftoff. Clearly, construction on Pad B is nearing completion and will be ready in a month or two, in line with previous predictions for August or September. The next steps will likely include initial system testing and full hardware integration. If things continue like this, SpaceX is poised for a major breakthrough by the end of the year. It's not just SpaceX that's making moves. NASA is doing its own thing, but things don't seem to be going well for them. They've faced criticism for years over their high costs, and the future of NASA's space launch system remains uncertain. The future of the Space Launch System, SLS, is becoming increasingly clear. If the president's new budget cuts go through, the SLS program could be canceled right after Artemis 3. That means the Block 1B and Block 2 versions of the rocket may never launch. But NASA isn't giving up on SLS. It's still working on building Mobile Launcher 2, and a key part of that rocket's future is about to be tested. A new solid rocket booster called BOL, which stands for Booster Obsolescence and Life Extension, is being developed by Northrop Grumman to upgrade the Block 2 version of the SLS. The new booster isn't expected to fly until at least Artemis 4 and is essential to improving the rocket's performance and replacing older components. On June 26, NASA conducted a static firing test with the BOL booster at Northrop Grumman's facility in Promontory, Utah. The test was intended to simulate the 2-minute engine burn that occurs during a real launch. However, about 2 minutes into the test, something went wrong. A sudden flare-up erupted, and moments later, a massive explosion occurred, with debris flying from the back of the booster. The test operators were surprised, but the issue was not mentioned further during the broadcast. Jim Kalberer, Vice President of Propulsion Systems at Northrop Grumman, said, "We saw an anomaly toward the end of the burn. This test gives us important data to improve our design. While the incident wasn't a total disaster, the debris does indicate that the SLS boosters still need further work. The team must quickly figure out what caused the problem and fix it, because even a small problem could put the mission at risk. The SLS solid rocket boosters are 150 feet, 47.5 meters, tall and about 12 feet, 3.8 meters, wide with a nozzle 14 feet, 4.4 meters, wide. They are made of carbon fiber and can produce about 17.35 million newtons, about 4 million pounds, of thrust. Thanks to their improved performance, the Block 2 version is expected to be able to carry up to 5 tons more into low Earth orbit than the current Block 1B version. However, it remains uncertain whether this new design will ever fly, especially since NASA's proposed budget for 2026 suggests canceling the SLS program after Artemis 3. Many support the budget cuts because each SLS launch costs billions of dollars to develop, produce, and maintain, including the Orion spacecraft. Ground systems like mobile launchers and new propulsion technology have increased costs. This is a major investment for a program that may not go beyond Artemis 3. The Office of Management and Budget has suggested major cuts to Artemis infrastructure. This includes reducing the Lunar Gateway, canceling upgrades to the Orion spacecraft, and cutting funding for mobile launchers. While NASA is still moving forward, these proposed cuts represent a decline in political and financial support for the program. Let's look at the costs. According to NASA's Office of Inspector General, each SLS launch costs about $2 billion. On the other hand, SpaceX's Starship is intended to be fully reusable. Currently, its launch costs between $80 and $150 million. But SpaceX plans to get that down to about $100 million or less once it is fully operational. This could save NASA a lot of money on long-term missions and prevent taxpayer dollars from being wasted on an outdated launch system. Second, Starship can carry up to 150 tons to low Earth orbit and can carry crew and cargo to the moon and beyond. In contrast, the SLS Block 1 can only lift 95 tons, while the Block 1B and Block 2 can lift 105 and 130 tons, respectively. With in-orbit refueling, Starship could surpass the payload limits of the SLS. In addition, its landing capability means it could combine the roles of the SLS and Orion into one integrated system. That's all for this episode of Harge. See you in the next episode, and thank you for your support.